You know, I hope you know how an AC generator works. You're gonna be powered by solar, be powered by water, powered by all sorts of things. Isn't that neat? The flow of electrons, the imaginary charge-carrying particle that Nikola Tesla, James Clerk Maxwell, Oliver Heaviside, Eric Dollard, and countless others, actually geniuses of electrical field theory, said didn't exist. It's purely conceptual, kind of like the photon. Now, in an AC generator, there's actually no direct contact between the magnet and the coil. The four phase, I don't care what phase AC generator we're talking about, but there's a flow of electrons generating that electricity. And of course, we actually have to, specifically, by the way, and I've said this before, however, not recently, that the way an AC generator works, it's literally a magnet turned inside out. As far as the field structure, the dielectric reflector, where the plane of inertia is on the outside, or in the case of a magnet, that would be directly on the inside, at the plane of counter space. And the magnetic field, which of course is on the outside, the toroidal geometry, is on this case the inside. And altered change with respect to time, you actually get a field perturbation that we call electricity. And electricity is phi times psi equals Q and Planck of electrification. In other words, electricity is a hybrid of dielectricity and magnetism. But none of this is important. There's no direct contact, nor is there actually anything directly flowing as far as particles from the actual coil to the stations. Specifically, if you ever thought this is a great way to destroy someone in the cult of quantum, which is specifically has its foundation based in atomism, do you or anybody else on this earth believe that there's a bottomless tube of toothpaste that I could just keep squeezing this damn thing until, you know, it would be unending? There's a bottomless tube of toothpaste. Well, no, there's X number of milliliters of this, 6.4 fluid ounces or semi-fluid ounces. Obviously, yeah. So, nihil ex nihilo. In the case of power generation, where do you think these electrons are spontaneously manifesting from in the case of the coil respect to the magnet? Now, we could also talk about wireless power induction like your Apple Watch or your toothbrush. And of course, there have been countless experiments. There's even several patents based upon completely wireless, by the way. They're getting the future. We've already gotten into 1 watt wireless power charger. You place a coil on the back of your phone. You have the sucker plugged into your wall, and your phone is always charging as long as it's in a certain room. However, that's going to create its own issues because if you have a pet, it's going to start chewing on its own butthole and running around in circles because animals are sensitive to that stuff. They're going to find out very, very quickly that this wireless power induction for charging your iPad and your iPhone and all your other stupid eye devices is going to start causing skin rashes and, you know, making your cat chase its tail and climb the walls. And it's not funny, but that's exactly what's going to happen. However, there's some brilliant patents based upon that. But there's no direct contact there. It could be in a vacuum. And, of course, the induction would still incur. So what is it that you actually think if you are, of course, lost? Point being, if you're lost in the cult of atomism, how power is manifested spontaneously out of nowhere. Nihil ex nihilo, from naught comes not. Do you think that these electrons... Well, there's a flow of electrons generating electricity. In the case of, like, Hoover Dam, for example, you know, there's an enormous X number of kilowatts per... Where do you think, since you believe in atomism... This unending bottomless tube of toothpaste, in this case we're talking about electrons, is manifesting from? Is it actually coming from the copper coils themselves? If that were the case, then all the electrons would have been stripped off of the respective copper atoms within a very short period of time. Then you'd have to replace the coil. Well, we generated X number of kilowatts. We already stripped all the electrons. Those generators have been in place there now for decades and decades. So where do you think the spontaneous, and this is what you should ask a scientist or someone that's lost in the cult of quantum, where do you think the spontaneous generation of these electrons comes from? Well, you know, it's the flow, because that's all they'll ever tell you. It's the flow of electrons. Okay, well, let's talk about the flow of electrons. Now, kilowatts is a lot of power. Of course, Hoover Dam and Niagara Falls, various places, they're generating a lot of power. And that's all well and wonderful, lights a lot of homes. But where do you think if you believe in electrons, that these charge-carrying particles are manifest. Because also, too, if you believe that charge-carrying is actually a particle, then you also think that the power lines outside back your house are, you know, like rain sticks, you know, those aboriginal rain sticks, that there's just like trillions and trillions on every microsecond, just little tiny BBs. Do you think, because some scientists will actually say, and there's very, very few of them, well, the electron particle is really conceptual. It's basically for helping us understand that. But almost all of them will tell you that it is an actual entity. You know, it is a actual physical particle. It is flowing from point A to point B. The way an AC generator works is it causes the flow of electrons, or exact words, by the way, because the flow of electrons manifesting. And, of course, so where do you think these electrons are spontaneously manifesting from? If you believe in atomism, then you believe in absurdity, wherein which nihil ex nihilo, every microsecond, or every nanosecond, really, in the case of like a high power generator, endless gazillions of electrons are spontaneously popping into existence, flowing through the Like I said in the prior video and countless videos, there's only two foundations of reality. One is based upon atomism, and it, which makes no sense, nor does it explain observable nature. And the other one is based upon ether perturbation modalities, you know? Because everything is a power and a pressure modality. It'd be electricity, which is a hybrid of dielectricity and magnetism. Dielectricity and magnetism, and of course, gravity is just a misapprehension of what we call magnetic attraction, which doesn't exist, which is dielectric acceleration. The difference being is one's mutual mass acceleration, and the other one is point source acceleration. The exact same distinction between a laser and a light bulb. Now, if you ask a person, what's the difference between a laser and a light? Well, I know a laser from a light bulb. It's like, yeah, aren't they both light? Yeah, but they're radically different entities. Well, they're not. One is point source, and the other one is not. Gravity, if we want to define gravity, or the phenomena of gravity, here's gravity right here, okay? Yeah. It's no different than a light bulb. It is non-point source emission. People say, well, laser light is coherent light, and that's incoherent light. Attributionally, that's the case, but specifically in denotation, a laser is point source emission. Yes, yes, yes. Most people don't realize that most lasers have focusing beams on the front, focusing elements on the front of them, all those laser pointers, all that. They have glass elements on them to collimate the laser light. Yeah, so that's the distinction between, and I think that's really a perfect analogy, like laser light versus a regular incandescent light bulb or an LED light. That's actually the reason why LED is actually intermediately positioned between a regular light bulb and a laser. LED light actually is point source light, and of course most lasers are LED now, but the reason why LEDs are bad for your eyes is that they're point source light, but that's a matter for another discussion. But the reality that natura naturans, or Mother Nature, is mutually interacting, bumping particles, cannot be enjoined. It's illogical, it's untenable, and it doesn't explain countless observed phenomena. Not only of field theory, but of light. Because this is, and the way that the idiots of quantum explain this, and almost all of them do, and you know, if you've ever researched the stupidity of the crap that comes out of quantum, they literally say this, and you should pay attention to this, you could look it up anywhere. The really spooky phenomena, they call it spooky, which is a nice way of saying, man, this shit's strange, we don't understand it. Because they can never explain instantaneous action at a distance, IAAD, with bumping particles, because particles can't move instantly, because nothing moves faster than the speed of light. Of course, there's no such thing as the speed of light, it's a rate of induction. Is that they will say that all these countless exotic phenomena observed, it's a quantum effect, it's quantum tunneling, or it's spooky quantum, sometimes quantum doesn't really make it. And they will say this themselves. The biggest ones, Leonard Susskind, the dead late Richard Feynman, and all the rest of them, the big wigs of quantum, i.e. the crazy people. Well, this stuff doesn't superficially seems highly illogical, but you know, in the realm of quantum, it makes sense. The reason why it doesn't make sense to them is because their entire foundation of reality is based upon atomism. That everything's a bumping particle. Well, what's happening here is this quantum particle is tunneling in subspace and is manifesting. When you start calling stuff spooky and inherently contradictory, then you don't really have a correct grasp of the nature of reality, but that is exactly what the folks in quantum do. You could read it from their own mouths and the tips of their own pens. Well, this is spooky action at a distance. This is a quantum tunneling. This is a quantum interaction. This is very typical of the quantum, very typical of the quantum peculiarities of phenomena we observe. Superficially, they don't make any logical sense, but in the realm of quantum, they do. And you just end up back at leprechauns riding farting unicorns, which is what quantum is. Yeah, so ask a scientist how an AC generator spontaneously, out of nothing, nihil ex nihilo, manifests a gazillion electron particles. Let's say the flow of electrons. But yeah, where are they flowing from? And if you, like, turn off the power, do they all flow back? Well, no, of course they don't. No one has ever said that. But logically, that would be, so what do you do? You're stripping off all the electrons from the respective copper atoms in the coil of an AC generator? Well, no. Well, where are they spontaneously manifesting from? They got no answer for that. It's because there's no such thing as a physical. They literally think, most of them do, that an electron is like a little subatomic BB. You know, and when you turn on the power, there's like a gazillion of them flowing down the wires in your backyard there and the power lines. This is stupidity. It's rank stupidity, actually. Thank you so very much for watching. I hope you like these videos. If you do, you click the link below. Tell me how much you hate me. Yeah? Good.